Hi all, welcome to our YouTube channel, and we are back with a very important, so to say, crash course on China, because China has been in news recently, and today we will briefly go through the history and the relation that India has with China and the recent developments that we shall be discussing and talking about, right? So it will be featuring background on China, then we will be talking about the rise of Communist Party, timeline of India-China relation, issues like trade deficit, the border dispute that we have then, which is like the McMahon line, and all other such related issues, alright? Then we have the world foreign diplomacy that we'll be discussing, and the way forward that we can have with China. So to start with the background, Now, the Shang dynasty is the earliest ruling dynasty in China, and how do we know that? It's because we have found certain archaeological evidences like the bronze and the jade artifacts which help us date the history of recorded history of China back to the 1600s, alright? So, moving on from that, we have the era that was marked by the birth of Confucius, who happens to be a very important personality, and his ideas and philosophy are very central to the Chinese culture. And he was a proponent of personal and government morality, and a very, so to say, a narrow A version of his idea, a tailor-made version of his idea, is being followed by China in recent time and is being used by China as a soft power diplomacy. So that's that. And then we have move on to the Qin dynasty that was established during this period, and it's also here from where China derives its name. And now the Qin dynasty is also very important. Because it ruled China till like the 1640s and the 1911, and in between China fought two opium wars with the Great Britain, and it is here where the future of China was, the China that we know now, was decided. So what happened was, like, up until the first opium war, this particular Qin dynasty, or in other words, the Manchu dynasty, followed a policy of seclusion or isolation. And it was able to sustain this isolationist policy because China was pretty well sufficient in all its good and its fact, as you can see in the map here that I can show you. As you can see, the Shang civilization. Now, China shares a very long coastal area, so it was, and also a lot of rivers like the Yellow River, the Mekong River. It flows through the region, and it makes the region pretty self-sufficient and resource-rich. And this is also one of the reasons why China had balance of trade with its. Balance of trade with other countries and the rest of the world, alright. Now, but what happened was that in the second Opium War in the 19th century that China fought with the Great Britain, it lost, and it had to open up its economy to the rest of the world. And this is where trade relations, inflow of foreigners, diplomatic relations were set, alright. And this is also the advent or the beginning of Europeans coming into, like I said, the trade relations happened and Europeans came, and they tried to force their way into China to take advantage of this resource-rich region, so to say. And here the European nations actually wanted, the idea of this European nation was to make China an exporter of raw material and importer of finished goods. And to end their policy of inclusion. Hence, Great Britain, as it already had fought the two opium wars, interfered and ended China's policy of exclusion. And also, the other European nations, what they did was that they established their spheres of influence. Now, what this means is that Some nations had special areas which were dominated by them, and they were conveniently used by them as their rights and for their purposes, and the ports and all those areas that they had under their control was used by them. All right, and this is also where we see the entry of USA into China in the late 19th and the 20th century, where US was influential in adopting an open door policy for all nations, and it was here the free trade of China and began, and all the other nations started dominating the Chinese affair, so to say. Now, all of this created a lot of resentment in China. All right, the people were not happy with how the European powers were treating the Chinese, and they were agitated because the Qin dynasty did not do much about this situation. So what happened was that also in this time a lot of Chinese educated youth was returning back to radical revolutionary ideas, and they wanted to overthrow the government, establish democracy and a stable institution that they had seen in other countries where they had gone to pursue their education. So one very prominent figure here we will introduce is Sun Yat-sen, who actually established the Kuomintang or the KMT party, which we will see in the later video how it had its issues with the Communist Party. So all of this resulted into the rebellion, and the Taiping Rebellion, which is the most famous, where the people actually fought with the Manchu rulers, and they wanted to establish their democratic ideas. And this was also the beginning where the provinces started asserting their independence from the central government. All right. So, and in between all of this, we have the KMT party, which was set up. Now, what happened was that the Manchu ruler rule ended in a revolution because of the Taiping and other agitation that had precipitated in 1911. And what happened was that afterwards, pure chaos, because China was completely disintegrated as it did not have a central power to control it. And because of this, a lot of factions emerged, and each area was controlled by a warlord having its own private army, and they basically fought among themselves for the resources and to gain prominence. And this was actually the beginning of warlord era, and here the Chinese Communist Party was born, because the farmers had suffered a lot of hardships because of that. What happened was that all of this eventually led to the May 4th movement in 1919, and here is where we see the birth of the Chinese Communist Party, who was very empathetic towards the atrocities that was faced by the farmers. And a lot of students gathered, and mass demonstration had happened, and the Chinese Communist Party was established in the year 1921, as they were sympathetic with the cause of the peasants. Alright, now here we see there was an animosity between the KMT and the Chinese Communist Party, which later resulted in the Chinese Communist Party winning the game. So what happened was that the Kuomintang was a leftist oriented party, and they were against the Chinese Communist Party, because they had their ideology was communist based, of course, and they were focused on peasant welfare through land distribution methods, and they were not at all pro landlords, which the KMT was. And here is the animosity further deepened. And also at that point of time, Chinese Communist Party was not that militarily strong, and hence they were easily suppressed by the KMT, who was pretty much strong in terms of military. Now, even though KMT's aim was establishing democracy in China, yet they were not along with the line of the communism. Alright, so also here is where I will introduce how Soviet Russia began supporting the KMT. Now also a little diversion we will have here is because the Soviet entered, because this is also the time there was a lot of tension between United States and the Russia back then, and they wanted countries under their camp so as to have a greater influence. And this is where the Chinese, the Russians, the Soviet Russia was supporting the KMT with cash and with military training and with arms, with the hope of having a very friendly and united China in the future. And on the other hand, the Chinese Communist Party was formed by the leftist individuals in 1921. Alright, so that's that. Now then, what happened was that from 1930 to 1934, the KMT initiated an encirclement policy, alright, and they wanted to destroy the Chinese Communist Party completely and exterminate them in the combat. And but with the support of peasant and Mao Zedong being the leader, the Chinese Communist Party gradually started to get more areas under their control, and they provided an honest administration. They were pro-peasant, and they brought in a lot of land reforms method. Now all of this, now as you can see, if a party is doing well for its people, they will obviously get the support from the people. And this is where the KMT's encirclement campaign did not work out much, because the Communist Party was growing stronger and stronger. Now in between, we also have the Sino-Japan War that had come as a part of the World War II, and KMT was busy fighting the Japanese army. And it did not, even though with all the might and the power, it did not win. But on the other hand, the Communist Party came up with this guerrilla warfare strategy in this particular war, and they had won the war. And this particular situation had also again helped them garner the support of the peasants and the people of China in their support. And they also led to an establishment of nationalism and patriotism among the people. Now after the war resumed again, there was a civil war between they resumed, like the Communist Party and the KMT resumed their animosity, and which led to a civil war. But here again, what had happened was that because of other nations had also became a part of this particular situation, where the US and the Soviet Russia, they decided to give back all the territories that they had occupied in the war. And what happened was that USA, since it was against China, was supporting KMT by handing over the territories to KMT. And on the other hand, we have Russia, who was handing over territory back to the communist. All right. Now, Communist Party of China. Now, this led to two camps. Now, these camps were also adding fuel to the fire and adding to the animosity between KMT and the Chinese Party. Now, what happened was that finally, in the year 1949, the Chinese Communist Party was victorious, as it's also called as the Red Army, that it was called. And the head of the KMT back then fled to Taiwan, where it set up a government in exile, and also the government of USA later recognized the Chinese Communist Party, and this is how the Chinese Communist Party came up on the map. Now, when it comes to the phases of India-China relation, we started with a very policy of appeasement, so to say, with China, and this is evident from the fact that when the Communist Party came to power, India was the first non-communist country to recognize this particular communist China. All right, and But we already had a lot of issues with China. But in between all of that, the then Prime Minister Mr. Jawaharlal Nehru came up with this solution of Panchsheel Agreement, which the countries later signed, where India accepted Chinese sovereignty over Tibet. But in this particular situation, I like to mention here, he was criticized heavily back home because though we accepted Chinese sovereignty over Tibet, we did not claim for an equal Chinese acceptance of our sovereignty over the Aksai Chin and over the Nifa region. All right. So that is one situation here. Now, in the following years, what had happened is that a lot of skirmishes had happened, and India granted asylum to Dalai Lama in between, and the Chinese started constructing highway on the Trans-Himalayan region, and all of this actually when India accepted Dalai Lama's asylum, when India decided to give Dalai Lama asylum, China was not very happy with the situation. And all of these was in a way violating India's territorial sovereignty, China was growing more and more aggressive and impatient with us, and all of this resulted in the Indo-China War of the 1962. Now, obviously, India lost in the war, and we had paid a very heavy price with the policy of appeasement and with the policy of brotherhood. And also, one important lesson that we learned from this was that we need to strengthen our own defenses and not trust China, because it is a very authoritative, a very closed nation, and also very unpredictable, so to say. So this led us to the second phase of our relations with China, which was right after the war, 1962-1990, which is also the phase of cold peace in India and China relation. Here, India was very adamant on prioritizing the border disputes, prioritizing our own country, and engaging with China in a very strategic way. What happened was that there were several rounds of negotiation to deal with the border dispute between China, and China had offered a solution also, where it said that to accept China's sovereignty, it would accept Arunachal Pradesh as an integral part of India only if India had accepted Chinese sovereignty over Aksai Chin. Obviously, we did not agree to such an negotiation, and there were dead ends. And over the years, the border dispute never really settled, and the matter simmered down. And then this led us to the third phase of our relation, which was more cooperative based approach. And also, we had in the year 1993 our Narasimha government visiting China, which led to an agreement on peace. Now, the third phase of relation in India-China was important, it was established because of the growing unilateralism that was being faced by India and China from the United States. And in order to have a united Asia, and in order to have a calmness and a certain sense of peace in this region, we had to unite ourselves with China in order to establish a multipolar world also. So because of that, in 2005, we also signed a strategic and cooperative partnership with China to establish such a multipolar world in the event of unilateralism which was faced by China. All right. So now moving on to the next, we come up with the issues that we are facing in the India-China relation, starting with the trade deficit. Now, of course, India and China, we have a huge trade deficit with China, and also because the Chinese the exports has increased, but on the other hand, our imports to China have decreased because China has been neglecting our demand since we have had made the demand to open up their IT sectors, their pharmaceutical sectors, and to this will enable to increase our export. But China has been very neglectful of this particular issue. And also a little bit statistic that I'll give you here, that that bilateral trade between India and China had declined by about $3 million last year, and the trade deficit continues to be high, amounting to $56.77 billion, because also the countries have been facing certain amount of slowdown in their economies. And also one thing needs to be noted here is that Chinese export has increased by 2.1% last year, while India's import to China decreased by 0.2%. So this, obviously, this trade deficit is a very big irritant in the India-China relation. Then we have the China-Pakistan Economic Partnership, which is a part of or a very important component of the Border Road Initiative that we have. Now this particular is an issue because this Border Road Initiative passes through the Gilgit-Baltistan region between India and Pakistan. And this clearly is violating India's territorial sovereignty. Then we have the Brahmaputra river dispute, river water issue that we have, where the China's runoff river projects and the apparent experimenting is leading to a lot of pollution in the lower courses of the Brahmaputra river. And obviously, as we all know, India is a water deficit country, and this problem is further aggravating to our situation. Then moving on, we have the McMahon line issue. Now here I would like to point out that India-China's border dispute is actually divided into three sectors, all right? The first one we have the western sector. Now this is basically the area, this particular area that we see, the red one here. This is the Shaxgam Valley that was gifted over by Pakistan to China. Now this particular, and along with the Aksai Chin, provides a clear-cut entry or a route for China into the Xinjiang province that was also in news recently. So this is a contention area for us. Then we have the central sector. Now a lot of issues have been simmered down here. We don't really have much skirmishes in this particular sector. Now this actually included your the Tibet region and also the Sikkim area and a lot of other the Tibet region here. All right, but it's not, and also certain parts and pockets of Uttarakhand also. But it's not really much of an issue here. And then we have the eastern sector, which is very much a part of the problem. This is also the McMahon line area between Arunachal Pradesh that we have. So now in China has been along with the Aksai Chin and this area here. China says that this is the outer part of the Tibet, and hence it is a part of their area. But since because of the McMahon line is being refused by China, and it says it's very impartial and has not been very much following this particular issue, and it also says that it denies India's claim over Arunachal Pradesh also, and refuses to accept this particular line. Then we have minor issues like the, also I would like to point out before I move further, the recent Doklam issue that we have. So it was at the tri-junction of India, Bhutan and China, alright, it was here. Now why Doklam issue was such an important issue? Okay, before I move further, you can also mention this in your mains answer, I would say, because the fear the Indians faced was that, since as you can see, This is where your Siliguri corridor is. This is the only route that we have that gives us entry into the northeast region. So with the Doklam and the construction of the bridge here by China, there were fears that China would enter and block the Siliguri corridor and our entry into the northeast region, and hence completely cut off the northeast region from India. So hence India had to get involved in this region, and also because we have friendly relations with Bhutan and we wanted to protect Bhutan's territorial sovereignty also. So that's that. Now, and also lastly, in the security issues, I would like to mention how how China can never be trusted by India, because China was, since India had actually voted for Chinese into the United Nations Security Council, but China has been apparently blocking our entry into the UNSC. And also earlier China was very reluctant to grant Masood Azhar, even though who happens to be a global terrorist, on the global terrorist list, because even though a lot of countries were protesting for him to for protesting him to be under the global terrorist list, but China was very reluctant to add him only much later, and from a lot of a negotiation that it had agreed to add him on that list. So that is, these are the issues that is being faced by China. Now moving on to recent development. Now in the past few days, a lot of China has been in news because it has been, so to say, has been harming the territorial sovereignty of India. Now, how is it doing that? Now, in one instance, I would like to focus on the Galwan Valley in Ladakh. Now, the Galwan Valley actually flows from the disputed Aksai region to the to Ladakh in India, and it then joins the Shok River, and it is one of the upstream tributaries of the Indus River. Now, what China has been doing is that China has been trying to cut off the waters of the Galwan River and basically starve us of the much needed water that India has been requiring, since we are, as I like to point out again, a water deficit region. So this also amounts to the weaponization by China. And all the other minor skirmishes that has led to China, India not trusting China, and led to a warlike situation in recent times. Now, now China is also, by doing this particular act in the Galwan Valley, China is violating the line of actual control between India and China. Now, all of this, so to say, is because China is engaging in the Wolf War diplomacy issue. Now, the main aim is that, now the political intent behind, so to say, all of this is simply to put India on the defensive. Now, in the wake of the recent pandemic that we are under, China has been questioned for its ways in containing the pandemic, and a lot of allegations has been made on China. And so China is putting India on a defensive so that India does not join hand with US and other nations to investigate into the Chinese methods of controlling the situation and making it a pandemic in the first place. And that's why not just in India, China has been being very aggressive in the Taiwan region also, and it is extending the China's national security laws to Hong Kong and violating the commitment of the one country two system that it had made earlier in the 1997. All right, now all of this is actually this particular aggression that is being made by China, and the other minor activities that the China is engaging for, to say, the string of pearl theory that China is engaging, where it's constructing and having a presence in, so to say, Sri Lanka, like the Hambantota port, or in Myanmar, or the Gwalior port in Pakistan, and it's trying to encircle India and dictate the term of our foreign policy with India, and also hamper the security security of India. So all of this is actually termed as wolf warrior diplomacy, where China is being on the defensive and acting into and being aggressive in its foreign and diplomatic actions with not just with India but also with other countries. So that's that. And yeah, before I move further, so here this is the map that I wanted to show. Here is your Galwan Valley. This is the Aksai Urchin, the Siachen Glacier, the Shak's Gum Valley that we say. Alright, so please note that. Now moving on to way forward. Now I think China should adopt a pragmatic approach in dealing with, India should adopt a pragmatic approach in dealing with China. And since China uses two particular policy, that is engagement policy and containment policy, and India should follow similar steps of using a mix of these two as and when required to make China understand that we will not stand up to the big bullying, big brother bullying attitude. Then also China should focus on rebuilding its defense capacity and promote trade relations extensively to reduce the trade deficit, not just with China but with other countries, so as to not come under the Chinese debt trap that that we say, where China grants loans at a very higher price for a much longer time period. Alright, then also India should cooperate with US, Japan and other like-minded countries to control China through peaceful and strategic means, through through platforms and other organizational approaches. Also, I think I would like to say promote and talks along the Quad that had the US, Japan, Australia and India, the Quad Forum. India should revive and deal with it and use this particular platform to raise its concern about China's aggressive policies and also the Border Road Initiative that could potentially lead not just India but many countries into danger and the Chinese debt trap. So that's that. And so that's how we covered our India-China relation and also the Chinese history and the recent developments. So if you like the video, please share and subscribe to our YouTube channel, and we will be coming up with more such videos in the future. So thank you.
Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon for all the latest updates.